you're not going to invest in yourself, what are you doing? I mean, like, that's the whole point, is to be here to learn and experience and to take, or to get the most out of life so you can give the most to life, right?
This is Entrepreneurs the Playbook, where I give you access each week to the world's greatest athletes and executives about their personal and professional playbook and what has made them champions on and off the field. This is the Playbook. This is Dave Meltzer with Entrepreneur the Playbook, and I have Derek Lunsden, good friend, and he's here visiting in New York at this great mastermind with Scott Duffy.
Awesome.
Welcome to New York.
Thanks, Dave. Good to see you here.
Good to see you. Well, you know, we've done a lot of work with scrimmage, and the reason that we do a lot of work with scrimmage is I like companies that take a different perspective to things. Wayne Dyer always said, if you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change. And in the human resource space, you know, to me is the most important, because I own businesses, I run businesses, I grow businesses for one reason. I want to empower others to be happy, and that's people.
Totally. We have the same value in that regard.
Which is why I love you.
Yeah. Ditto.
Well, as a young entrepreneur, you know, how do you take your passion, make it a purpose, but you've done a great job of making it profitable. What were the first steps for you?
Thank you. Well, the first thing is we had to find clients that believed in the vision and mission that we were building, which was how do we leverage technology, in particular mobile phones and tablets, to provide a more personalized educational experience, right? And so we found a few early adopter customers that frankly saw the chance to do something before others did, right? To think outside the box, to change the way they were doing it. And frankly, they took a bet on us, right? We were an upstart, a bootstrap startup, and they said, you know what, these guys see enough that we're willing to take a chance.
And I think you know you had a good idea, because there's certain industries that move at glacial speeds.
Yes.
And within those industries, there's certain people that are the kings or queens of CYA. Right?
So true.
If you don't make, as long as I don't make some different change, I'll be fine, because I'll keep my job and everything will run smoothly. How did you overcome those two real big hurdles in your space?
Well, so I'm glad you raised that, because that was one of the theses that we originally had. We were going to go after the learning management space aggressively, right? We said for years, people have been telling us how much they don't like this technology. We've built the future. It's mobile. It's lightweight. It's user focused. And we went in there, and most of the companies we met with said, well, even though we told you that, we would prefer to preserve our jobs and not make the change, because we've invested a lot of time and a lot of money. But over time, we were able to find another group of individuals, frankly, the marketing team, that was more open to pushing the envelope a bit. And then once they did that, the people who were resistant to the opportunity and change wanted to grab a hold of it, because they said, this is our business, we should have it. And so we kind of worked around
And then resistance. They took credit for it.
And then they took credit for it.
Oh, 5 years ago we told Derek this was a good idea. Thank you for doing that.
And I don't care. That's all good to me.
Well, it's interesting that you went to the marketing side, because I believe in internal marketing. And,
totally.
And it's interesting, because I, you know, have worked with your software and solution, and I believe in it, because it's almost an introspective solution.
Yeah.
It takes an internal marketing.
Yes.
And an internal enlightenment, and then you take that information and improve productivity, efficiency, statistical success, and purpose.
Yeah.
Now, so you have really a good start.
Yeah.
But you know, there's a million great ideas and a million good starts or pilots.
Sure.
How did you transition that pilot into actual profitability?
So exactly what you said. We proved that what we said we would do actually worked, and the technology did what we said it would do. That people saw massive savings, right? They saw increases in their productivity, measurable increases to their sales volume, right? And so people were frankly getting promoted, right? So that goes a long way to people willing to take the chance. And
right.
So we started just socializing our successful clients with other people that we wanted to become our clients, and they started doing the selling for us, right? And then we continue always to innovate on our product, getting it better and better, trying to see the market ahead of time, soliciting feedback from our customers. And so because of that, we keep doing what we say we're gonna do and improving it and improving it and improving it. That tends to attract people that want to also, you know, ride that success and you know, apply it themselves.
So a lot of young entrepreneurs and companies like yours, they have a successful pilot, but they don't know how to aggregate the data correctly or sell the value correctly. Yeah. What were some of the tricks that you used to sell that value or tell the story of success?
Well, so two things. One, we built the technology. We actually architected it for the purposes of collecting the data, right? So everything in our platform, we can see what content's being accessed, by whom, what frequency, what file format, right? So the data that we wanted to, you know, prove out as our thesis is there, right? And then we allowed our clients to basically run the analytics and reports themselves, separate from us. So it wasn't our opinion.
It was theirs.
They were their opinion, right? So they're the ones that are saying, we're seeing this success, we're doing this work, we see this content. Scrimmage is an asset to it. And then we would work together with them to help socialize and get the message out there, right? And so, and then obviously working with great partners to help us market it and create materials and resources and things like this that allow us to socialize and expand our message, right?
Right, and the message goes beyond just word of mouth, great videos and marketing, et cetera. You're holding a baseball.
Yeah.
And I think this was just a great idea. Explain the story of the baseball.
Thank you. So this is.
I know you used to pitch for the Yankees, right?
I wish.
You're gonna sign this for me, aren't
Absolutely,
you?
Absolutely, I will. Absolutely, okay, cool. I will. So this is our latest social media contest. So about a year ago, I was sitting there. I was sitting thinking about how can we do something fun with our marketing. How can we apply gamification, which is part of what we do on our platform, to our business? And so I said, we have a sports theme. Scrimmage is about games and about fun. Why don't we do something around the summer, right? So we've had this whole contest around frisbees, where we would say, here's all these frisbees. You know, go out and play, take pictures on Instagram, post them on Twitter, post them on Facebook of you learning and having fun in work, out of work, with your friends, with your family, show how learning applies. And that was really well received. And so the beginning of this year, we had, you know, the NFC Championship game, Minnesota versus the Eagles, where two of our offices are. We did the scrimmage kickoff. We had the football. We did a charity auction between a Minneapolis charity and a Philadelphia charity, where they were basically competing for bragging rights, right? So that was a lot of fun. And then it just has taken over itself. We did the World Cup with soccer balls. We did beach balls this summer for our second scrimmage summer contest. And now we're doing scrimmage World Series, right? So the idea is that whenever you're traveling for business or you're doing meetings or whatever it is, you take our baseballs, you go into a baseball stadium, you put your team's gear on, and you take some really fun creative pictures with your family or your friends or whatever, and post it up on our social media channels with our hashtags, @WeScrimmage, learn when you play, play where you work, Scrimmage World Series, and we do all the different types of things, and we'll give you points and tokens for participating. And by doing that, we're building our community, we're building our brand, but also people are having fun, and they're also winning prizes, right? They're winning gift cards and drones and trips to places. Yeah, we're doing some cool stuff.
All right, you got my media my media guy's attention. We're doing one today.
Okay,
yeah,
awesome.
Make sure.
I love it. Let's get Brian Cashman now on the picture.
Yeah,
for sure.
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course. We're going to have a great interview with him, too, at this mastermind. Now, you guys have trademarked Scrimmage Playbook.
Yes.
The name of this is The Playbook.
Love it.
I can't but help ask you, what's your playbook to success?
So my playbook is, frankly, to always be learning, which applies to our business, be humble, and seek to meet great people that can help, you know, the business, and we can help each other, right? And I think that is the fundamental thing that's allowed me and our company to be successful.
It's interesting because as a young entrepreneur, when I was your age, that's when I screwed up everything. And you said a really important thing that resonated with me was be humble. And to understand humility at a younger age is essential, because those who are humble ask for help. And the one thing I really, I'm so impressed with you as I started working with you, is that very few young entrepreneurs take such an effort to invest in themselves. And I'm not just saying you spend a lot of money investing in your own development.
Yeah.
So although your business is about development, you actually personally have great personal development, and you make great investment, not just money though, but time.
Thank you.
Like I have my eye on, you know, this weekend with my dear friend Ed Milet, right?
Yeah.
And you had an extraordinary, ROI is tremendous, right?
Yeah.
And here we're doing a mastermind. Just, you know, we have better things to do on a Saturday, both of us.
Sure.
Right? We both have kids, right? We have families. Yeah. But in the end, if we're not stronger, if we don't work out, eat right, develop ourselves, everyone's gonna suffer.
Totally.
And we can't do it every weekend, right? It's not where we live, it's where we play.
Well said.
What is the statement, if you don't invest in yourself, what are you ever gonna invest in mean to you?
If you're not gonna invest in yourself, what are you doing? I mean, like, that's the whole point, is to be here to learn and experience and to take, or to get the most out of life so you can give the most to life, right? And so it doesn't even register for me that you wouldn't do that on some level.
Right. And then, but people don't.
Yeah.
And then how does your solution apply to that statement?
So our solution is about personalization of education, right? So on your phone or your tablet, you can access content of any kind that's relevant to you, whether it be, you know, mindset or business skills or anything. I mean, Spirit, we talk about Wayne Dyer. If we wanted to put content related to your personal growth, we could put that in there. It's any type of content, delivering it in a format that's gamified, video-based, micro-learning-based, that we can measure and see the impact that it's having on someone's life or whatever goal they want to fulfill on.
What is the biggest mistake? You get to see all these businesses. Right? I always said, being a salesperson when I first started out, it really helped me because every day, five, six, seven businesses, I would say it was an MBA in a day because I was getting all this input on how things run. What's the biggest mistake you see companies making?
Well, I think it's changing, but the biggest mistake I've seen companies make over the last 10 years is not seeing their people or seeing people as the single differentiating asset of their business, right? I work in the training and development space, you work in the space. For most of business up until this point, people are looked at as an expense. Training is looked at as an expense. It's looked at as a line item. It's one of the first things that is cut when the economy turns. But we live in a world now where people have so much information and people have the choice of where they want to spend their time and their careers in a way that never before has been a reality. People have a choice. And companies are being forced to reconcile that there's a mutual value and values exchange that's taking place. And I think that's a big shift. And I think that, you know, the smart companies, the best companies, are investing in their people. They're creating programs that are helping people succeed both in and out of work, and they're looking for creative ways to add more and more value in that regard, so they receive that exchange of value and values, which I talk about a lot lately.
And I also see you talk about something really simple, but I think extremely valuable, and it's like a happiness factor. Right? You know, happy people are more productive, they're more efficient, they stay with your company, and it doesn't necessarily mean pay them more.
Correct.
What are the key components to keeping your employees happy?
Well, so I think, you know, work is called work for a reason because it's about challenge, right? The idea is that you want to give people something that's challenging for them. They want to give something that's, again, back to personalization. What are they motivated by? Are they motivated by travel? Are they motivated by new experiences? Are they motivated by meeting new people? Are they motivated by learning new skills? Are they motivated by providing for their family, right? It's up to us as leaders to understand each person, what do they find most important and what's going to motivate them? And I think that that's where, you know, it goes back to human resources. Like, we're human beings, right? We're not resources, we're human beings. So how do you understand that being and what's important to them so that they can ultimately understand what's important to the organization? And the integration of those goals and those values goes back to, you know, motivation and how you keep people engaged, keep people committed, and that ultimately, the more you keep practicing that, the more you build trust. And with trust, you create opportunity.
Right, motivation is inspiration. Yeah. What most companies don't realize is that, and I say this about people, there's two types of people, those who motivate or those who manipulate. And I believe there's two types of companies. And employees see it right away.
Absolutely.
Right? They either feel motivated or inspired. My goal, besides, I'm one of the few people that's an entrepreneur, I want to make every one of my employees a millionaire in the next 10 years.
Love it.
Right? That's my
same.
I'm motivated by that. But what they don't realize is that people see through manipulation.
Yeah.
And for years, companies thought they were fooling their employees.
And they did.
Right.
And look what happened. Look at the trust that evaporated within corporate America. Right. And that's why we have the gig economy and the sharing economy.
Right. And why we also have people moving and transferring jobs at the fastest
100%.
Rate, which is the most expensive thing to any company.
Absolutely.
Is to lose an employee. Especially a good one.
Yes. We talk about this all the time.
I bet you do. And your solution is so aligned with that critical business issue. How do you discuss the ROI side, right? Because here we're on the emotional side, and now the reason you're so successful, I believe, is you're able to put it to a quantitative return on investment.
Absolutely. So it goes back to you've seen some videos recently about onboarding, right?
Yeah.
The onboarding, bringing on new employees is one of the most critical success factors because it's your first impression, right? That, to your point, that's where you create trust. That's where people know that you're about motivation and about actually developing them and not just one end goal, right? And when you do that, you build a culture of learning, of community, of trust, all the things that people want to be a part of these days. It's about cause and purpose as much as profit, more than any time, right?
Yeah.
And so by doing that, you know, you're paving the way for an employee to be with your organization for a long time and for that relationship, that mutual exchange to happen over a long time. And when that happens, you just expand, right? It compounds all the time. And so that's really what it's about. You know, we measure how do we improve someone's skills. We measure the impact that they're contributing as a result. We measure how quickly they get up to speed and are contributing to what they and you want them to do. And then over time, you just keep practicing that. Right? I think that's the biggest thing. It's a hard thing. It's, I mean, leadership is an art and a practice, like you and I have talked about. You have to work on it all the time. Us as executives, our teams, and everyone, at the end of the day, we're still people, and we all have to work on getting better and better and better. And when you create that opportunity and that culture, you'll see the ROI.
Last question. Do you use your own solution at your company?
100%. That's, I mean, it's without a doubt, it's a given. Yes, we eat our own dog food.
And what's the, when you first instituted or implemented your own solution, what's the biggest takeaway that you had by using it?
We need to get fresher content in there. Like that, one of the key things, it goes back to delivery is important, but you always need to be giving updated content and adapting the content to how the market and the company and your industry is changing. And that's important that you bring the best of both the delivery and the technology with, you know, relevant material and resources that speak to that reality.
Are you seeing a bigger demand for Dave Meltzer content on there?
We should definitely talk about that channel.
Oh, good. Hey, it's right there with Wayne Dyer, who's awesome. My mentor. We can have the Meltzer Dyer.
That's a whole conversation. We should talk about Wayne Dyer, because I used to do, I still do, his meditations for manifesting. And they were really, really critical for me as I was working on developing this practice of self-development.
Well, there's a reason when I tell people I work out, and they say, really? It's because I work out to Wayne Dyer.
Wow.
I'm thinking more than I'm working out.
Yeah.
But no, he's got a little Wayne Dyer look going there, Derek. So not too bad, which I think is a compliment.
Thanks, man.
I really love your solution.
Yeah,
I love the idea. I'm
going
to get you to sign this for me.
Awesome.
But thank you so much for coming
on.
I really look forward to working with you. I always call it co-mentoring.
Yeah.
Because anyone that I do business coaching with and mentor, I learn like in this conversation more than I sometimes
awesome,
give.
Man.
So thank you so
much.
Thanks,
I appreciate it.
This is Dave Meltzer with Derek Lunston, Entrepreneur, The Playbook.